Yarn Chat number 15. This is a Wyoming handmade podcast where I talk about life in rural Wyoming and a bunch of handmade stuff. It's usually mostly knitting, realistically, and yarn that I never actually knit with. I just have because it's beautiful. This time we're actually going to talk about a little bit of crochet. I do some cross stitch and weaving, stuff like that. I've been away from the podcast for a few weeks, and that's because we took a business trip for my full-time job, which I will talk about briefly, not too long. I know it's not interesting to most of you. Because of that, I feel like I can't really talk about like finished objects and works in progress without first talking about that trip and all the places I went and the things that I did and saw. So there are, I'll just warn you right now, there's not going to be like nice, clean sections that we can go through. It's a little scattered, but I did make some show notes so I could try and like keep it all together and make sure that this is not too long. First up, some administrative things. My computer is back, and I am so excited about it. Very briefly, my computer had a hard drive failure, and there are no Apple stores in Wyoming. So it has been, I've been without a computer, I mean my primary one, since like November. So the process of getting it fixed, unfortunately, was not without a bunch of hiccups, but it is done. With that, the reason I'm telling you this is that we can finally like get in a groove with the podcast again. I feel like every time I sit down to film, I have to cobble together a different setup. This setup is actually a little different than the previous setup, based on like, I'm using, Alan got me a new iPad, which I'm using, which is lovely and fantastic, but I just want to use the computer again. So as I was getting ready to film this morning, I'm looking at it right now because it's downloading stuff. As I was getting ready to film today, I noticed that it does not have iMovie on it. Unfortunately, with that hard drive, they had to just bomb out the whole thing. I lost absolutely everything. I lost my logo. I lost all previous yarn chats. I lost, if you've ever been to the blog, which I haven't been using at all lately, years of my blog just gone. So I have to start fresh, but that's kind of exciting. That means I can like, you know, I've been podcasting for over a year now and I wasn't doing them that frequently. And then I had that really long downtime. So this gives me a chance to like kind of rethink things, like come up with a new logo. I noticed that the lovely Katie from the Inside Number 23 podcast uses the same song that I was using. I don't know how long her podcast has been around. I don't even really care. I think it suits her. And I was thinking about changing it anyway. So I'm going to get a new song and we're just going to like revamp this whole thing. So that is, I'm excited. It's very excited. Computer's back. We're going to be back in action. I have really, really missed you guys, missed podcasting with you. I was like able to briefly check in on Ravelry while we were on our business trip. And I felt like there was all this amazing stuff coming in my group and other groups that I couldn't really contribute and discuss. And that really bummed me out. So I'm like more inspired and amped than ever to really get this thing going. So great things all around. Really excited to be here today. I didn't say it, but it is Sunday. Is it St. Patty's Day or yes? I don't know how St. Patty's Day works. I've been informed that this is St. Patty's Day weekend. Obvious. I'm wearing blue. There's a little green right here. We're not doing anything for St. Patty's Day. I don't even know if there's anything going on in town. This will likely be going up, hopefully, fingers crossed, on Monday. Yeah, so let's get going. So administrative stuff, I think that's really all I needed to talk about. The other kind of administrative-y thing that I wanted to do was just go ahead and do the giveaway for the, I'm doing a project in my group. It's called, the kind of short name that we've come up with is 12 in 12. The whole theory is we all have these beautiful single skeins of yarn and we are coming up with 12... I'm not 12, we're coming up with a ton of suggestions for perfect one skein projects, whether they be hats, mittens, socks, shawls, baby sweaters, all different kinds of things. The info thread, the general thread, has a ton of different suggestions of perfect one skein projects. So my February project was my sock head hat. I showed that off last time. I don't even have it here with me today, but we had a giveaway item submitted, or donated rather is what I want to say to me, as a prize. So I have that here today. I have, so because I don't really structure the threads, I don't have a chatter thread and a finished object thread. What I did was I debated, you know, just picking a number for the number of posts that we had in February. And then I was thinking that it's likely that a lot of people chattered, but maybe didn't finish an object. I see a lot of the same names, so I don't know if that's realistic. I didn't really audit it that much. But what I did was scroll through that thread, come up with a list. You can see my horrible handwriting, like chicken scrawl, scratch as I was getting ready for this. I came up with a list of every finished object that I saw in there. And so what I've done is just numbered those in the order that they appeared. And then I put a reference post number on them, because on my computer over here, I have that thread open. That way I can click over and, you know, see your name and all that kind of important stuff. So let me queue up the thread right now. Hopefully this won't take you too long. Okay, you guys can see if for some reason I missed somebody, it is literally because your photo just didn't appear. I checked it multiple times. So this is like the order, these are the names, and then this is the post where your finished object was posted. I have definitely not restricted people from submitting more than one project, and quite a few people have done multiple, so that just means more chances to win. So the prize was donated by the lovely, her name is Lizzie the Mama on Ravelry, and she has a yarn shop. The prize for March, I showed off in the last video, is going to be a skein of her hand-dyed yarn. This month, she didn't tell me what month it had to be. I just picked this one first. This is hand-spun, which is amazing, Sweet Georgia in the color Lakeside Drive. So you can see it there. That's actually a really good color representation. Beautiful, just squishy, kind of lofty. I think it would make a beautiful cowl, hats, whatever it may be. I really like this. So I'm going to steal from Julie. I saw her do the most genius thing in her video last night, and that was to just ask Siri to pick a random number. So we're going to do that. We had 25 finished projects. I need a number between 1 and 25. Okay, never mind. Apparently my Siri is insane. And I said her name and she was like, calling Eric. That is not what I wanted her to do. So scratch that. We were good. She never generated anything. She started playing an album. My Siri has issues. So I'm at random.org. We had 25 finished objects. So 1 to 25. Generate 23 is the winner. So 23 is, of course, one I can't pronounce, P-O-K-D-E-J. That was post number 58. So right at the end, we'll go there. She made a pair of striped socks. Vancouver, British Columbia, Canada, and no name, unfortunately. But if you see this, get a hold of me. Otherwise, I will get a hold of you and send out your beautiful new yarn donated to us. So there we go. That's done. One thing out of the way. So next up, I was trying to kind of figure out how to do this in a sensible order. And I thought the first thing I would do is actually show off a finished object that I have. That finished object is a knit along that I'm hosting with Julie, Diary of a Yarn Snob. Julie, I saw your video where you say that you love when people call you Jules. I'll try and convert my brain over. It's been Julie for so long, but I think Jules is the best. I love it. So this is my finished three-color cowl. The pattern is the three-color cashmere cowl by Hohi Locatelli. We've been hosting this knit along for over a month now. It's ending at the end of the month. And I showed mine pretty much done, but it hadn't been blocked and the ends trimmed. So I've done that now. So it is done. It is bigger than I expected. Beautiful, really soft. I used 3 50-gram skeins of Luette Gems Fingering. That was, I didn't pick out the colors. They came in a yarn box socks. That's kind of what spurred us to actually make this project, is that I had these 3 skeins and I thought it would be a perfect match for the pattern, and they worked out perfectly. I did have to kind of alternate the order of things to make sure that I took full advantage of all the yarn that I had because I didn't have any extra. So there we go. I'm going to put it on. I don't think I've put it on yet since it's been blocked. That's attractive. So it's just a lovely, dense, squishy cowl. I'm really pleased with it. Mine is done. Holy hair. My hair is going to be all staticky now. I know. I know some people said that they had issues with either binding off too loose or not loose enough. This is my bind off edge. I'm really happy with it. Honestly, I think all that I did was when I want a loose bind off, but I don't want a super like stretchy bind off, I just size up like two needle sizes. So I knit this entire thing on a size 3. So for the bind off, I would have used like a 5. And I think it works really well. Very pleased with it. Really pleased with how this yarn blocked out. I was using it because I had it, but it wasn't it was a very nice yarn. I think it would be beautiful for actual color work, like Fair Isle style color work. Comes in a nice range of saturated colors, but I really just used it because it was in my stash from Yarn Box and I wanted to find an appropriate use for it, but it matched up perfectly with this pattern. Really, really happy with it. It's kind of like a springy palette, but it is getting super warm here, so I don't know how much longer I'm going to be able to wear it. So I might just stash it away for the fall. So that's done. With that, I thought it was time to finally I've like so much stuff in front of me. I'm trying to find a place to put everything. It's like very organized chaos in front of me right now. I cut like a foot of my hair off in Salt Lake City. So I'm still trying to get used to it. So sorry if I'm adjusting it. I don't really know how to deal with hair this short. We'll get there. So I giveaway for the 3-color cowl. That's what I wanted to do. Prizes. Julie and I are like, we're chatting, of course. We talk all the time. But we're not really like strictly coordinating our prizes. But I have dug through my stash and ordered something, and this is kind of the direction that I'm going in. So I saw this bag from the Fawn Knits in her Etsy shop. I don't know what I'm doing. I can't see when I hold it up. There we go. That's what I wanted to do. Cute little tag over here. I love this print. I love this color scheme. Just plain inside. It's got this adorable mint zipper to go with it. This would be perfect for socks. That's what I would use it for. So reluctantly, I'm bummed about it. But just because I love it so much and I wish I could keep it, I'm going to be including this bag with my prize. And then I have a skein of yarn from Toil and Trouble, who I also purchased from Etsy. There's the tag. This is a tweed, kind of a nubby texture. I love this so much. This is another one where, I love giving a prize, but I'm always sad to see something go. It is this teal with this beautiful grayish brown. Really, really love this. Really soft. It is an 85% superwash merino, 15% nylon, 438 yards, sock fingering weight. And I'm not sure if imprint is the name of the base or the color, but this beautiful, beautiful skein is going to be one of my prizes. Well, there is one prize. It's going to be part of that one prize. And then I don't have it here in front of me, I see now, but I have found kind of the last remaining bits of my felted bowls. So I'm going to be including one of those. So those are the prizes you guys can look forward to. Have a chance to getting. In my threads, Julie and I are doing it a little differently. She has one thread that she's just leaving totally open. I have a chatter thread and then a finished object thread. I am definitely allowing chatter in the finished object thread. I think nobody is because they're just so used to not being able to. You guys can comment on other people's projects. Definitely. I just wanted all the finished objects in one spot so it was easier to comb through them. That's the only thing. So if you see a project that you love and you want to chatter about it, go for it. No problems. But I just wanted the full-on chatter sharing yarn discussion problems, whatever it may be, in the chatter thread and then a separate finished object thread. So that is where I will be selecting a winner from. I think that's all. So my three color cashmere cowl is done. We have new ones rolling in every day. I'm like so in love with how everybody's using the same pattern, but they all look so different. We have so many coming in. I don't even know the full number. Maybe I can click over there right now. Really just a lot of finished cowls coming along. A lot of stuff. I get tagged in on Instagram, so I love seeing your progress. Happy all around. Okay, next up. So this is where the order gets a little funky. I'm going to talk about mail first to kind of set the stage for everything else I then want to talk about. So prior to leaving for this trip, I got a box in the mail and it was from Julie. I don't intend to talk about her the whole time, but she just comes up for a variety of different reasons. This time the box was a prize that I won. I think it was, she had these finished object threads where you could submit anything that you finished and you could submit as many times as you wanted. And then she just pulled from there. So I think it was December. And we had chatted about it prior and she had asked if she could hold on to my prize because she also wanted to send me one of her bags. So I said, of course, no rush. So the official prize was, and I'll show you what's in here in a bit, was a Mrs. Brown's bags. And I feel so cool to finally have one of these because I have followed her on Instagram for so long. Let me take some stuff. This was, I packed this for my trip, so I have like random just stuff in there. So let's clear that stuff out of the way. One moment. Pens? Sure. Anybody need a pen? I can never find a pen, but apparently I have two in a knitting project bag. Okay, and there is a project actually in here, but I wanted to show you this tag. So Mrs. Brown's bags. Handmade in Canada. You can go to mrsbrownsbags.etsy.com. Love this print. At first I thought it was almost like a wood grain, but it's this like beautiful watercolor, kind of brown mauve. Really, really like it. Love the size. Cute zipper pull on the side here. So this was my winning prize. Yeah. And then we'll talk about this project in one second. And then with that, Julie also sent one of her bags. And I feel like I got, you know, she's so close to starting this Etsy shop. And I feel like I got one of the first edition bags. And I'm really excited about it. Also, lots of stuff in here. Kind of like my travel knitting supplies and the project itself and ball bands. But this is a huge bag. I mean, it's not a sweater size, but what I have in here is a three color shawl and it fits no problem. Nice and wide on the bottom. This lovely kind of almost upholstery texture. It's got a little bit of texture to it. I mean, upholstery weight fabric. It's a little heavier than just a normal cotton. She got these cute little tags to put on them. I think she said this is what was causing the delay. She was waiting on her tags to come. So DYS bags, very pumped about it. And then along with that, she sent, I could smell it before I opened the box. It is this Filthy Hooker soap in oatmeal honey. Look at how cute this is. Love it. I have not opened it explicitly so I could show you guys. But, you know, now that I think about this, I think that Linda, who has been in Hawaii for a few months now, might have found these for you. Julie, tell me if I'm wrong. So amazing. So I, now that I've showed you, I can open this up and put it to good use. So love that. So that is mail from Julie that showed up a few days before we left. And then where do I want to go from here? Let's talk about my subscription boxes. So I have received my last Yarn Box Socks. I've been a Yarn Box Socks subscriber since, I mean, a good 6 to 8 months, maybe more, maybe almost a year. I should have thought about this beforehand. A while. And I, you know, there wasn't a reason to cancel. I was just kind of done. I felt like I had gotten my fill. I never got anything bad. I got some maybe less than desirable things. Nothing bad. There's an active trade thread. So if you get something where maybe you like the yarn, but you don't like the colorway, really easy to trade it. So no complaints about Yarnbox socks. It's a fair price. I was just kind of done. So first up, when it arrived in a box, normally we get them in a little bag or tube. When it arrived in a box, I was like, oh, what's going on here? So this is my March. I already showed you my February Yarnbox socks. This is my March Yarnbox socks. So if for some reason you are a subscriber and you haven't received yours yet, look away. But I think we are sufficiently into March that everybody has gotten there so far. So let me show you this really fast. Noise. So they always include this little slip that talks about the month. It says piece of cake. This month you have received a special treat from Yarn Enabler. You think we all know that name by now? Your hand-painted fingering wool has been dyed in a double gradient, meaning both ends are mirrors of each other. When knitting, you'll purl from the center as well as around the cake to make near matching pair of socks. Awesome. So this is obviously, I mean, it's Yarnbox socks. Rarely do I use my yarn for socks because I think a lot of times it's nicer than something I would use for socks. This one is clearly for socks. I'm going to have to use it for socks. So Yarn Enabler. There's the tag, hand-dyed wool. I'll show you the color in a second. The colorway is called Water. It is 390 yards, 80% superwash merino, 20% nylon. You can find her at yarnenabler.com or, of course, on Instagram, which is how I know about her. So there is the Water colorway. It is a beautiful saturated. It goes from like a royal blue to purple to royal blue to this aqua color. So I guess since it's a mirror, it's like this, 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 and then then reverse of that. So I would say all the way in there, there is some teal as well. So I have kind of challenged myself to learn to love knitting socks, and no better way than doing it with a beautiful gradient. So I think that if I wanted to get rid of this for some reason, I decided it wasn't for me. I'm pretty sure this is a pretty coveted color in the Yarnbox trade thread, so I could easily get rid of it, but I'm going to hold on to it. You know, we'll talk about socks in a second, but I think I'm going to put it to good use. So there's that. Beautiful. And then the other club, the only other club that I am in, just like throwing stuff around me, the only other club that I am in is Republic of Wool. It is a 3-month club. It was a 3-month prepay. I received my January, so this is February. I received this the same day that I received this. So it was like the happiest mail day of all. This color. Do you ever find yarn that you love so much you almost don't even want to use it? I just want this to exist as it sits in my stash. I'm not even looking at the camera, you guys, because I'm just looking at the screen. It's so beautiful. Look how it just like matches everything that's behind me. My whole life. It's beautiful. It's got this lovely mint green, this like maroony pink, a little bit of purple, this like brighter green golden color. This is their twist fingering, which is, it's always the same base, the twist fingering. 80-20 merino nylon, 400 yards. The colorway is called Penny Lane. Love it. It's not a complaint. I'm not going to say my only complaint. My only like, is that I really love I know that these bands are popular for a reason. I would say that they keep the skein together nicely, so they're important, but I really loved her black tag. Obviously, that's not a complaint, just a comment. So beautiful. This arrived mail. So those are, I was going to say those are like my standard things, but randomly getting bags in the mail is not a standard thing at all. Those yarn clubs are like my standard thing. And with the exception of yarn clubs, I mean, it's about to get crazy, guys. Like, intense. So with the exception of those yarn clubs, and Republic of Wool is brand new to me as of January. And Yarnbox Socks has been going on for a while. It's $22 a month. With the exception of that, I have not bought yarn in a very long time. True, like maybe Thanksgiving. I just haven't really been adding to my, definitely not. I mean, I don't know about December. I could have done some stuff in December. But, you know, January, February, March, I feel like I'm not really showing all that much. I really haven't been adding that much to my stash. So, I warned you guys that when I went to Salt Lake City, I was going to check out yarn shops. And let's talk about Salt Lake City for a second. Let's start there. Lies, I have one more thing that I got in the mail. Oh my gosh, I told you I wasn't going to be so scattered. Mail, let's finish it up. Fawn and the Fox, the lovely Laura, I watch her podcast, I follow her on Instagram, have her forever. She posted on Instagram, she started dyeing yarn, and she posted on Instagram that she had a few remaining skeins from like an earlier update, just to let people know, like, hey, there's still a few in the shop. And I had been thinking that I wanted to pick up a bag as a giveaway for Three Color Cashmere Cowl, the bag I already showed you. So obviously I ordered. And what I got was these two beautiful skeins. This is Raven base and Magpie base. The Magpie has gold Stellina in it. So this is her, the color is called Gold Digger. Magpie is a fingering weight, 84% superwash merino wool, 16% gold Stellina. And then Raven is her fingering weight. This is a Grand Budapest, but she says it's a one of a kind. So maybe it's a Grand Budapest that's like not necessarily able to be replicated. I still love it. And I actually got these because I thought that they could go together well. This is, I mean, it's more of a green, but I think there's a little bit of that gold tone in Grand Budapest. So these two came in the mail. I will mention these again later for a reason. I got them kind of thinking of a project. So, mail done. So Salt Lake City. Back to where I was. So scattered. Still. We went to Salt Lake City for a work trip. Briefly, I'm sure you guys know by now, but I own a small business in our town in Wyoming with my husband. My mom is a co-owner with us, but she's in Michigan, so we run the place on a daily basis. And twice a year, we have conferences. This one is our snow conference. If you've been watching for ages, you'll remember last time we were at Disney. We were in Orlando, but at Disney. We went to Disney, we went to Wizarding World of Harry Potter, all that great stuff. And then we have our ORV one. So that is in the end of summer, well, July, August, late July, early August. This year it's in Nashville. It's often in Las Vegas. So we never really leave Wyoming except for these trips. So when we go, we like think about like all the things we want to do. And that's why it's like I cut off a foot of my hair. I got an iPad. I got all this yarn. It's because we just don't. We don't go to Target. We don't go to Home Depot. We go to Walmart, which is 90 minutes away, and that is it. So we are not like big luxury hobby spenders normally. So when we go out of town, we kind of take advantage of the situation. So as part of selling snowmobiles, I get this little, it's like a rewards gift card thing, and I hoard that for these trips in the hopes that I can use that money on something that is not like groceries and dog food, something that is like just for me and that I'm excited about. And obviously that's yarn. So the trip was good. The work part was good. We already, as of 3 weeks ago, need to be thinking about the orders that we're going to place for next winter. So in March, April, we place orders that don't show up until November, December, and set the stage for our next season. So it's an important trip, and there's a lot of work to be done, but they always do a really good job. If you're from Salt Lake City, we stayed at the Grand American, which is a beautiful hotel, right in the city. It was great. They always do a good job. And then we just tacked on like 2 days to get my computer fixed and to run errands, to go to Target, to do just stuff like that. So, obviously, I wanted to hit knitting shops. I'm going to pause to take a drink for a second, and then we're going to talk about all the glorious knit shops in Salt Lake City. Okay, so in Salt Lake City, obviously going to yarn shops was a priority. So I pulled up my phone. I had been to Camille's. I think they're in West Jordan before. Had a good time, but I wanted to see what else there was. No complaints about Camille's. It was, I think I talked about it probably this time last year. Because when we came home from Orlando, we stayed an extra day in Salt Lake City. So it's probably like literally a year ago. I wanted to check out some other ones. So the first one that I found, because it was closest to our hotel, was Blazing Needles. This is actually in Salt Lake City. I have their little card so you guys can see. Guys, this, oh here, this is fun. Free beginner knitting on Saturdays and free beginner crochet. That's awesome. If you're in the area, take advantage. This shop, I like this second I pulled up, I was like, oh yeah. These guys know what's up. I also kind of like scoped places out on Instagram and Facebook to figure out if it was going to be a good fit for the kind of stuff that I like. So I walk in, it like immediately blew my mind. Just beautiful. It's in an old house. And it was still, I mean, it was a small place, but just well laid out. It wasn't crowded. You weren't like bumping into people. There were quite a few people there. So I walk into the first room, wall of Malabrigo and quince. And then I was like, dead. I was like, how am I going to handle this? I don't even know what to do. And then it was like overwhelming. So I walked down the hallway, wall of Brooklyn Tweed. And then I get to the back room and there's like, I don't even remember. There were these like beautiful gradient kits. And then like a whole, I mean, I was so excited. I forgot to go back to this, which I'm going to say a whole like area of Regia, Arnie and Carlos. And I wanted some and I just didn't even think about it because I was so overwhelmed. So my priorities throughout all this are one, I was taking place in the knitting expat swap. So I was trying to find something kind of local to send to my person. We decided to do two skeins. So I had one skein already set aside and I was thinking about what I wanted to get for this other person, the other skein. And there's a lot of Wyoming mills and sheep who like produce yarn, but not a lot of dyers. It's kind of hard to find. I've seen a few, but there are some companies that I know from my local yarn shop or that other people have sent me that I've come across. Mountain Meadow Wool, Palouse Yarn Company, quite a few lovely ones. So I was just looking for something like local. And then I was looking for colors for the grocery girls. Need no additional explanation. You already know who they are. And if you don't, you absolutely need to watch. I needed colors for their 3-color cashmere shawl. So as a follow-up to the, I don't even know where I threw it. As a follow-up to the shawl or the cowl that we were working on, Hohe just released a pattern for the shawl version and the grocery girls are hosting a knit along. So those were my priorities. So they did not have local indie dyes. There was a little bit of, I think it's MJ wool, MJ something. They had a little bit, but it wasn't really what I was looking for. It wasn't the right weight. I think it was like maybe a worsted or something. Let's start. 3-color cashmere shawl. I gotta get my brain right to say it right. I found colors and I've already started working on the project. So this is why like I kind of need to talk about one to talk about the other. So let me show you my colors. I got Malabrigo. I'm gonna say Makita. This is the tag. So you can see all the specs. I got it in 2 colors. I got it in, I think it's called Sandbank and Natural. This is the Natural. Right there. We're gonna set that there. This is the Sandbank. Uh-oh, created a bit of a mess. I don't have this in a project bag to show. It's just sitting on my desk here because I work on it all the time. Oh no, what have I done? Oh God. Okay, so they had a lot of Malabrigo sock, which was my first instinct. I've used it before. I like it. Great. But then I saw this Makita and it's like a single ply, which is, you know, I'm getting away from the single ply, but in terms of like my first love, like fingering weight single ply is kind of my first love. So here is Sandbank And it's actually, I mean, it's like a taupe color, but it almost has a rosy undertone to it. So these two were going to be my main colors. And then for an accent color, please let me have it here. Yeah, there it is. I got Quince & Co. Turn is the base. The colorway is called Rose Quartz, and there's no better description for the color. So there we go. Look at that beautiful little tower of yarn. It's very, you know, I love color and I use a lot of color, but I wanted something super wearable and almost not tonal, but subtle. And this is the color scheme that I came up with. Really, really, really pleased with it. So I haven't gotten, this is going to be my, there's like a band of accent color. That's what this is going to be. And honestly, I might not have enough here. It's 221 yards. And they come in 50 gram skeins. And I worried that if I got two, you know, they're not incredibly expensive. It wouldn't have been prohibitive. But I figured if I got two, I would end up with so much left over. Like, let me just get one and make it work. So unlike last time where I kind of extended that color up into the stripes, I'm not going to be able to do that. Like, one and done. This is all I got. For these two, there should be like more than enough to compensate if I run short anywhere else. So I have started, let me move these because I've started my shawl. We're going to hop around. I'm sure you guys will be okay. So this shawl, this is a crescent shawl. It gets quite wide. And this technique for increasing to make a crescent is my favorite. This is what's done for the iBlink pattern. This is also what's done for Truly Myrtle, Libby Johnson, I think is her last name. Libby's rattan shawl, which I've showed. Talked about how much I love it. It's the same technique for me making a crescent shape. So this bad boy, I already know is going to get huge. And I know that because I've done it similarly before. But these are my first colors. I'm not, because the, you know, with a shawl, unlike a cowl, you can really mess up your stitch count based on whether you, where you do and don't follow the pattern. So I'm going to follow it pretty closely. The only thing that I knew is that I wanted the light color to be the lace because I wanted this color to be a contrast border. So I'm going to kind of tweak placement to make sure that that happens. But otherwise, you know, just alternate these bands. I have one more row of eyelets and then I'm pretty much done here. And then I get into the skinny stripes and then I'm going to do the rose quartz for that big band and then lace and then contrast color. So this is chugging right along. It's like the rows get long. I mean, I've done these types of shawls long enough to know that the rows are going to get really, really long. But for now, it's going pretty smoothly, pretty quickly. This yarn is just like, it's beautiful. It's I don't want to say it's delicate because it's not going to pull apart or anything, but it's definitely going to fuzz. I mean, this is obviously shawl yarn. It's not really appropriate for anything else. So there we go. There's that. So that was my goal. One of my goals knocked out of the park, and I loved these colors so much that I went to a lot of yarn shops, guys, but I didn't question it. I was like, perfect, done. Check that one off. Great. So then while I was at, oh my God, I have so much down here. This is going to get good. So while I was there, I like couldn't help myself. And I got some other things that weren't on my list. So, I'll show you their little bag. And they also wrapped things like in, like so nicely. And they asked if I wanted my receipt emailed. So loud. If I just wanted my receipt emailed to me, I was like, yeah, man, rock on. Sounds great. I tagged them on Instagram and they immediately commented. They're great. They're with it. They know what they're doing. So one of the other brands they had there was Woolfolk. Do you guys know this? I follow them on Instagram, of course. This stuff is like ridiculous. It is so unbelievably incredible. Perhaps the most beautiful yarn I have ever touched and experienced. So they do really kind of natural, I mean, this is dyed. This isn't, I'm not saying that the sheep was this color, but kind of like, just like the aesthetic is very beautiful and natural, kind of the same colors that you would see in like Brooklyn tweed. This is a 50 gram skein, I'm sure. Yeah, 50 gram, 223 yards. It is the, here you go. Here's all the information. That's the back of the tag. In case you're curious. Per usual, my nails are messed up. I'm not disgusting. I sell snowmobiles. They get ruined no matter what I do. And I help in the shop all the time. So there we go. Front of the tag, back of the tag. So I believe, don't quote me, that this is a 100% American company. If you want to check them out, it's wolfoakyarn.com. It is 100% ultimate merino, it says. So this stuff is not cheap, guys. And I wanted like a sweater's quantity, but I had to draw the line somewhere. So I just got one perfect, beautiful skein to make like a hat, like an heirloom quality hat. Just so, so beautiful. And that's why, you know, they have this beautiful, like plummy Merlot purpley color, which I almost got for my mom, but I knew for a fact that she is on a strict yarn diet and didn't want to contribute to her delinquency. So I got, even though I wanted, they had like, I'm pretty sure they had like a sea foamy green, which is like totally up my alley, but I resisted and got something that would last me for forever because it's just so beautiful. So perfect. That amazing. I'm going to wait that one out and find like the perfect, perfect pattern for it. And then in tissue paper, this big old bad boy has just kind of been on my wish list for a while. It is Malabrigo. This is Rasta, I think is what. Yep, there we go. There's everything you need to know. Color, base, all that. Just the prettiest, squishiest yarn baby of a mega bulky. It's like super bulky. I don't know what. 90 yards, 150 grams, 2 stitches per inch. This is like a mega super bulky. Big cowl, winter cowl. That's all I'm thinking on. I'm just saving it for something beautiful. Again, like I almost just want to hang it on the wall and just let it be, let it exist in its perfection as part of my office. So I got that. So at that point I was like, okay, Blazing Needles, this has gone far enough. Shut it down. Oh, one more thing I got. I got a pair of, as part of my initiative to learn to love socks, one of the other things that I was looking abstractly for was different sock needles. And I told you guys before, like, I don't dislike knitting socks. And I'm using Nova Platina Cubics. They're actually like square. It just literally hurts my hands. It like rubs them almost raw in one spot. And I've tried to like reteach myself how I hold the yarn and it's just not going particularly well. So I, obviously these are in use. I picked up a set of, I'm pretty sure these are from there. The tag looks the same. Carbons, DPNs, US 1.5. That's a size that I like. So I picked up these while I was there. Okay. So from there, we went to, I can't believe Alan agreed to this, but we just kept going to yarn shops. So I was still on the hunt. You know, the one thing I didn't find was that locally dyed yarn. I was still on the hunt for one. So I went to, I wrote this down to make sure I got it right. I think it's called Unraveled Sheep and it's in Sandy, Utah. So this shop, totally different vibe. The vibe is like a little closer to most yarn shops that I've seen. Like Blazing Needles was very, I mean, an old house, so it wasn't in a modern environment, but like very modern and like perfect. And just like, I found it, the reviews say that it's not very friendly. I found it quite friendly. They were helpful enough. They asked if I needed help, but they didn't hover. No complaints at all. I thought it was great. Unraveled Sheep was a little more, I mean, it was still very well cared for. It was a nice big shop, but it was a little more like kooky, which is normally what I find in a yarn shop. So definitely not disappointing, but like more what I was expecting. And since I had already bought so much yarn, my only goal was like, let's find one of these locally dyed. My computer's doing something. Let's find one of these locally dyed yarns. That was all I was worried about. So where did I put it? I did find one. They had quite a few companies that I was excited about, but not necessarily the right colors. I mean, bear in mind that I wasn't buying for myself. MJ Yarns was there again. Anzula, which is, that's California. I wouldn't qualify that as like a Western company. They might have had some Mountain Meadow Wool, which was one of those that was kind of on my wish list. They had some gradient kits, which the gradient kits were beautiful, and I almost got one, but I felt like it wouldn't be the best match for my partner. So if I was shopping for myself, I could have gone wild, but I was shopping for somebody else. There was definitely more, like Blazing Needles was not a lot. I mean, it was all natural fibers. I don't think there was a single bit of acrylic in there, and it was more like boutique-y upscale companies. And Unraveled Sheep definitely had like your Barocco, Cascade, standard go-to stuff. So, which is not a bad thing. There's always a place for it. It was just like more, it's more what I was expecting. Whereas Blazing Needles was like, whoa, I haven't seen this before. So what I found, this company I am familiar with because somebody gifted me some of their yarn. So this is Greenwood Fiber Dye Works hand-dyed yarn. The cutest little tag. They are out of Colorado, dyed in the U.S. Man, I wish it said on here. I'm pretty sure that they're out of Colorado. I just know that. This is 60% superwash merino, 20% yak, 20% silk. That explains why it was so expensive. It's because of the yak. And it is a beautiful yarn. 100 grams, 400 yards. The colorway is called Mallard. So let me talk about this for a second. I think the yarn is beautiful. I like it, but I didn't love it for the swap. And those swap boxes have already gone out, so obviously I didn't send this. So this is now in my stash. Honestly, I think it would make something beautiful for my mom. It is this mix of greens and browns. Really pretty. I've never owned yak yarn before, so I wish I'd noticed that before. I should have, because it says right on here, yakety yak. I'm an idiot. Really like lovely, lovely yarn. So this would make the perfect 12 and 12 project. Like one perfect shawl from this beautiful skein of really, really nice yarn. And then while I was there, so I went ahead and got this. I was like, we are running out of options. I need something for this swap. Let me get it. I like it. I think it's beautiful. I don't know if it's the best. Not for me, for that person, but it's a really good option. So I picked up this. I'm going to add it to my little basket. And then I also got a set of, I think this is where I got my DPNs, Nova Platina. Just another sock option. Only a few bucks. I really like Nova Platinas a lot. Really, really enjoy them. They might be my favorite circular needle. So I picked up a set of these. There. And then from there, we went to one more yarn shop. It was just a few miles away. And I will say one of the nicest things about these yarn shops is that I flat out told them, I was like, guys, I'm here on vacation and I want to visit every yarn shop in the area. And they point blank said, well, you can go to this one in West Jordan, this one in Sandy, and this one. And they didn't tell me what type of shops they were. Obviously, it's competition. But they were very straightforward with that information. So Unraveled Sheep pointed me towards Knit and Pretty in West Jordan, Utah. So adore, this card is like so indicative of what the shop is like now that I think about it. So this shop was kind of unlike any place I've ever been in. It was like tidy, like perfect. They had all these bookshelves with the yarns put in like, you know, like this. So they were just like stack, 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 stack. They were all like this. So this is all you saw. In like, just like rainbows of color, like floor to ceiling, so much. And when I got there again, I told him just point blank, I'm looking for something local indie dyed. Like, what do you guys have? And I don't know if she pointed me towards anything, honestly. So because of the way the yarns were in, there were like beautiful colors everywhere, but I couldn't really figure out what brands they were. So I just started, I had to start like pulling out from these like cubbies, and they weren't like your standard IKEA cubbies that like literally every yarn shop has. They were like bookshelves. So I just started pulling them out, and I found a lot of Barocco, a lot of Cascade, and then I found Menos del Uruguay, and I was like, oh, hey, I'm a fan of this company. And then I found some Wonderland Yarns. I found Ella Ray in all different weights, but at that point I had like bought so much, I was only after local hand-dyed yarn, and I didn't really find it. So beautiful shop, very well kept, but not what I was looking for. So I did walk away with just a few things. These are just things that I needed that I was pleased to find more. And I think, like, I don't know what this stuff normally goes for because I don't have a frame of reference, but like extra cords. I needed long cords. I was working on a project with my Knit Picks. I love my Knit Picks tips. I hate the cables. They ruin the entire experience. I hate them so much. So I just wanted more Knitter's Pride cords. That's what these are. This one was 40 inch and this is a 47. And they have like the little stoppers and keys. That's all. And then again, on my hunt for sock needles, they had these Chow Gu 9 inch, which I actually have, but I think I have them in like a size 3. And I picked those up before I'd really knit socks, and I didn't understand that you knit them at such a tight gauge. So these are just a little circular, $6. Worth a try. And then I picked up just something that I wanted but didn't need. This is Ella Ray, which I've used before. Nope, this isn't. This is, it says, I don't even know how to pronounce this. I always thought that there was like Araucania and then Huasco. So embarrassing. I'm sorry, guys. This is a company that I'm familiar with, but I've never seen it written out like this. Maybe they've changed the name of the company. This is just a worsted weight in a bright, 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 ridiculous pink. And the only reason I would buy this, I'm making mittens out of it. I already know. That's exactly what it's for. I need just like a nice, chunky, like really lovely plied insanely pink yarn to make a pair of mittens for next winter. So this is kind of like a functional thing, but I love supporting a local yarn shop, and I saw it and I wanted it, so I went for it. So I just got this and the needles. So I know it feels like a lot. I will say, throughout this entire process, I was like, when this card like stops ringing through, I gotta be done, like no more. And it just kept going. And it was like, I mean, I earned that money through bonuses for selling stuff, but it was like free money. So I stocked up. Okay. So after all of that, I had this like nagging feeling that I wasn't done at Blazing Needles. It was like so beautiful and so great that I felt like I wasn't focused when I went through, because I was just like, do you ever go in and you're just like so enamored with like the environment that you feel a little off kilter, like you feel like you didn't see it all? So we had to go to like an auto parts store of all things, like a Napa hub in Salt Lake City, to pick up a tool for our mechanic of all things. Like, this is what happens when we go to civilization. We have to do all these things that we never get a chance to do. And one of those is go to a distribution hub for an auto parts store to get a tool. And I obviously didn't go inside because I don't need to see more tools. I see enough of them. I was playing on my phone, and Blazing Needles was like 1.1 miles away. So my husband gets back in the car and I'm like, hey, so, I mean, bear in mind, he didn't complain about this. He didn't come inside, but he like doesn't get it, but he's not going to be opposed to it. So I was like, hey, this is the last one, I promise, but do you mind if we go back? And he was like, fine. So 1.1 miles later, I was back at Blazing Needles. So what I got, I felt like I didn't give Brooklyn Tweed a fair like look over, and I felt like I didn't give Quince & Co. a fair look over. I mean, I felt like I didn't give any of it sufficient attention. So I just went back. So what I picked up was, and now we're going to talk about another project. This is why I had to tell you what I got so I could talk about what I'm working on. Now it makes sense. Oh, I'm stuck in my yarn bowl. I got a skein of Malabrigo sock, which I've used before, loved it before. That hot pink behind me right there is Malabrigo sock. So this is just the sock in, it's 440 yards. This is a great, if you are looking for like an introductory nice fingering, this is a great one. You know, a skein is what, $19? Great colors, beautiful colors. Great for shawls. Surely it makes good socks, as it's called sock. I really like it. So I got the color Persia. Yeah. Which is, I almost didn't cast on because I so badly wanted you guys to see this in this skein, but I couldn't. I like couldn't stop myself. So I just did. This is what the ball looks like. And I worried that it would come across just all blue, but it's actually got this really beautiful gray brown tone in it. So it's I mean, it comes across tonal overall, but there's some really beautiful colors in there. This is like, yeah, there you can kind of see it. I wish it would focus. Maybe it's not going to. iPads can only do so much, guys. Really, really beautiful color. And the second I got this, I only had one pattern in mind, and that is Kristen from the Yarngasm podcast and Volenvine has released a new pattern, lace. And you know how I love really ridiculously lacy shawls. I like knitting them. It is called Ville de Smir, which is, I'm not going to speak German right now. And I'm like, pronunciation's horrible. My parents lived in Germany for a while, so I picked up, I didn't live there. It was when I was in college, but they lived there for a little while. So I took a few semesters of German, obviously not very successfully. So I am in the eyelet section of Ville de Smir. It is, I love it. It's beautiful. I'm having a lot of fun with this. I have made some changes because I can't not. I'm doing the pattern as written. I just did the edge a little differently. And then there were some pearls in the eyelet section where I have so many patterns that I'm working on right now that I wanted one that was just kind of like cruise control, and I wanted this to be it. So the eyelets are fundamentally the same. I just changed them up a little bit. So right now, I mean, nothing much to show. It's just my eyelet section. This is a triangular shawl. You do the eyelets and then you do like this fanned, it's almost like, I think she said fish tails, like mermaid tails. This little fanned lace section, and then you do a knitted on border. She's doing a knit along for it at the moment, which is what kind of pushed me to be like, yeah, okay, I'm just going to cast on. Like the last thing I need is a new project, but sure. So this is also going to be my 12 and 12 for March officially. One skein project. So you will see more of this guaranteed. It's like chugging right along. I cast on just a few days ago, and I am splitting efforts between this and two or three other projects. So I got that. And then I will say that Brooklyn Tweed was not what I was expecting. It's a very hardy wool. Like, great sweaters, great mittens, great hats. Not really, like, I don't know how it blocks. I've never used it before. It's just not what I was expecting. It's more rustic, maybe is the right word, than I was expecting. So I looked, but I didn't really find anything that, like, compelled me to purchase. But what I did find was I have had Campside shawl on the brain for ever. Months and months and months and months and months. And I have yarns in my stash that I thought I could make work, but I think it's supposed to be written on like a knitted on like a, maybe a DK weight. And everything I was trying to use was like fingering, which doesn't really matter. I can adjust for that just fine. But when I saw this, I decided to go for it. And I wanted a perfect everyday shawl. I've said before that the things I love knitting, like Vildesmere and Liz Christie, super intricate, lacy, ridiculous, but I don't really know how to wear them all the time. Whereas the things that I don't necessarily love knitting are more wearable. So I just picked up, I knew I wanted Campside to be like everyday, basic, go with anything, wear it to work, wear it with my winter coat, just a big, beautiful wrap. So I picked up 5 skeins. Hey, yarn. 5 beautiful skeins, you can see the tag, of quince, chickadee, heathers. There we go. Which is, it's a sport weight, I'm almost certain. Yeah, I would call it a sport weight. 181 yards for 50 grams. And what else do I want to say? I'm like just reading this and not even looking. It's a heather and the colorway is called Iceland. So 5 of these at 181 yards a piece. That's just under 1,000 yards, 900-ish yards. So this should give me plenty, perhaps even enough left over for a hat. Again, this is a sport weight and it's supposed to be knitted on a DK. But when I checked out, she asked what I was making with this. And I was like, oh, Campside, but I don't really care that it's not right. And she was like, yeah, that's how to do it. Like, if you know what you're doing, you can just adjust. It doesn't really matter for something like a shawl. So these beautiful, sweet little yarn babies will hang out for a little bit until I get the time to work on Campside. But 100%, that's what they're becoming. And part of the reason that I did these is because I just made a lot of stuff fall. I've had chickadee on my mind for a sweater yarn, but I wanted to try it out. You know, I'm not really, because my size is changing so rapidly, I'm not really doing any sweaters, but I think chickadee would be perfect. And what else? I guess that's it. So that is where I was like, no more. And then from there, we didn't go to any more yarn shops because obviously I have more than enough in progress. What else? I'm going to take a break, take a drink. This is so long. I already know there's nothing I can do about it. Somebody told me that they prefer if these were shorter. I'm just going to be honest. It's probably not going to happen. I do want to start doing them every week. I finally rationalized that. At first I was reluctant, like, oh, I don't think I can agree to it. I don't think it's going to work. I'm now down with it. It's going to be happening. So they will be a little shorter, but they will never be 20 to 35 minute podcasts. It's just not going to happen. Expect like 45 to an hour. It's what I like to watch. It's what naturally happens. And I love doing this and I want to keep loving it. So I don't want to force something that doesn't feel natural. So they're not going to be shorter. Hopefully I won't ramble all the time, but they're probably not going to ever be shorter. So one quick little break and then I will show you some more projects that I'm working on. Okay, guys, so pre-trip, I had these lovely new project bags and I wanted to put something in them. I had at that point kind of finished up anything. You know, I still have my lumpy space in progress. I still have Artesian Lord in progress. I love that pattern. I do not like the yarn that I'm using, which makes me very reluctant to continue working on it. But otherwise, I had finished everything up. I didn't really have anything in progress and I wanted some card knitting. So I have had these skeins. I showed these ages ago. These are Andre Sunit's Felicity Worsted. So I caked these up a while ago. Oh, I have the label here. I pulled this out. There it is. Felicity Worsted, which is 218 yards, 100% superwash merino wool. So I have had these for a while, but I could only envision them as being like a woven texture. And I saw them as being like pillows for either our couch or bed. And I couldn't figure out how to put something so small on my loom. My loom is quite large and I only know how to make like really long things. And I just couldn't kind of figure out how I would do it for something that's just, you know, the size of a pillow. Then I saw Tunisian crochet and I know how to crochet. I don't dislike crocheting. I feel like I don't have good stitch definition when I crochet. Sometimes I see crochet and the stitches just look like defined and like bouncy and lovely. I feel like when I crochet, it looks like a tangled mess. And I know I'm doing it right. Maybe I don't have good tension, or I need to size my hook up. I haven't figured that part out because I honestly just haven't committed to it that intensely. But I love crochet for its ease. And if you make a mistake with crochet, I feel like it's much easier for me to fix. And I like that it, knitting takes, in a car for me, I can't really do it with like without looking, and then I get car sick and all that. So I wanted something straightforward. So I saw Tunisian crochet and was obsessed with the texture. It is so beautiful. So I called my mom, who came out to Wyoming to watch our house, and asked if she had any Tunisian crochet hooks. She said she did, and she would think about bringing them to me. She said they have a few different places that they split time between, and she said if they were at the house that they were at, she would bring them. And then I went on Amazon and found these, and I said, don't worry about it. I got it. I'm just going to Amazon Prime. This was on like Thursday, and we left on Saturday. And it was like, if you order in the next 4 minutes and 58 seconds, then it'll be there on Friday. With like, if you choose one day shipping. So I did. I paid $3.99 to get them there in one day. So this is the set. It comes in like, just like all Knitter's Pride. I'm 99% sure these are Knitter's Pride. Just like all Knitter's Pride needles, it comes in the little set. This one's actually might be even nicer than my Carbon's case. They're just in here, and they have threads on the end, just like interchangeable needles do. Normally a Tunisian crochet hook, and I don't really know what I'm doing, so I'm sorry if I'm explaining this improperly. Normally it's just a really long hook, and the reason is when you do normal crochet, you only have like one live stitch on your hook at a time, and you like hook along, and it's always like changing what stitch is on there. I don't know if that makes, if you've crocheted, you know what I mean. With Tunisian crochet, you have lots of loops on your hook at any given time. So you need a really long hook to accommodate all those. So if you were making like a washcloth or a scarf, you could just have a long hook. That's what they are. If you're making something larger, it has to be on a cable. So I thought this was genius. You know, there's no reason that I can't use the cable for everything. And these cables happen to interchange with my current Knitter's Pride, Nova Platinas, Carbons, my Knit Picks, Harmony interchangeables. So just more cables. So this is the method I went for, and I really like it. The needles are polished bamboo and they're quite nice. I'm using an eye with a worsted yarn. I think I could stand to go up one more. I wanted to make sure that my fabric, let me finally show you this. This is the fabric that I'm getting. I wanted to make sure that it was dense enough that you wouldn't be able to see any stuffing through, but it also needed to be kind of open enough to really get nice stitch definition. So there you go. I think that this is just beautiful. You know, I had thought that I kind of lost interest in continuing here, and then now I see it and I'm excited again. So I didn't put a ton of time into it, but I did put some in, and I think it's the texture is just really lovely. I want like a Tunisian crochet sweater. How beautiful would that be on a garment? In like I would just do it in like a beautiful like khaki color. That's like an heirloom sweater. You would have it for forever. Really beautiful. I don't know how much the yarn's gonna hold out. I don't know how much it's using. I haven't really monitored it, but this was my card knitting. So there we go. That is one project that I'm working on. And I'm working on this like kind of at a lazy pace. This is not something that I'm aiming to finish by a certain time. You might not see it for a little bit, but it is in progress. So this is in my Mrs. Brown's bag, my prize winning bag. Nice handle. You just saw I put two skeins of worsted sitting in the bottom here, and they fit great. So lovely size. I don't know what size this is intended to be per like an Etsy listing, but beautiful. She now has, appropriately, since that's Andre Sunit's yarn, she now has an Andy collection, and I would love to have one of those bags. I'm going to watch for an update to try and get one. So there we go. That is in progress at kind of a lazy pace. It might be a few weeks in between when you see that. And then I'm going to talk about a failed project really fast. So I've had the doodler on my brain for a while. And I'm going to insert a picture in just a second. I was photographing my stash the other day because one of the things that I'm trying to do is really stay up on my stash on Ravelry. It is a great feature. I know a lot of people don't like to keep up with it, but one of the perks of keeping up with it is, I mean, it helps it. It makes it easier if you document your projects on Ravelry because you can just say use a stash yarn. But the other thing is before I buy yarn, I go on Ravelry to see what's on, see if it's in somebody's stash for sale, to see what the colorways look like across all different types of photography and situations. So it just, it helps create the knowledge base that we're all taking advantage of, which is why I try and keep it updated. And then for me, if I end up trading or giving away or donating or whatever, a skein of yarn for my stash, you could just like, boop, move it over to traded, gifted. I like it. It's really nice. It is. And if you are scoping out new projects and you filter them, sometimes it'll say like yarn suggestions at the top. I don't know what exactly what it says, but something to that effect, you'll be able to find it. And it will look at what you have and say like, you know, this many other people have used Quince & Co. Tern for this pattern. It's in your stash. Maybe it would be a good fit. It's great. So I was photographing yarns for my stash. And I saw, this is where I'm going to insert the picture, I saw these three together. And I thought, this is an amazing combination. So I decided that these would be, I had had a doodler on the brain, but I didn't really want to buy yarn just for it. And I didn't really know what color. So I thought that these three would work perfectly together. So I told you it was a failed project. Spoiler, they're not working that great together. And I have, I think, since taken my needles literally out of my doodler. But I still want to show you. So, oh, this is my, I had everything like in this bag for travel. So these are my like carbons and my little notions thing. This was from Tara from my White Elephant swap, this little bag. And then this was from Tracy, and it's a needle keeper. The best. I've showed these both before. And then I have all my little notions in here, so I don't need to go through that now. The yarns are, this is Mosaic Moon. I have this label. Mosaic Moon. The base is called Birch. The color is called Malachite. It is the perfect, there we go. It looks kind of forest green. It's much more of like a tealy green. It's got my hair on it. Awesome. This is Destination Yarn. And this is kind of where I think we hit a failure point. And it has nothing to do with the yarn. So don't think I'm saying that. I think the yarn's beautiful. But when it was in the skein, I think I thought it was going to have a lot more white in it than it ended up having. So this is what it looks like. And you'll see when it's knitted up, it's coming across much more of this. I don't even know what you would call this. Again, like kind of a Merlot color. It's a very red purple. And then this yarn is another failure point. This is a yarn that I've had in my stash for ages. My mom went to the Michigan Fiber Festival. I'm going to see if I can dig around and find. I have this bowl of labels. Here it is. I knew it was in there. Okay. Oh, and here's the other one. Sorry, guys. I'm scattered. Destination Yarn. There we go. I showed this recently. Summer Wedding is the colorway. It's the letter fingering. And then this yarn. So she was going to the Michigan Fiber Festival quite a few years ago and asked if I was looking for anything. And I said that I was thinking about knitting socks. Like 2 years ago, I was thinking about knitting socks and I'm still trying to get there. And she picked up this one. So this is actually perfect. The color that I'm seeing on screen right now is like a, it's called Red Grape. It's a very red purple. But in person, and this is what it looked like in the Instagram photo. And this matches this flawlessly. Look at that. Perfection. So this was my, this was what I was imagining. I thought like, man, That's perfect. In person, this has way less white in it than I thought. And this one goes from being a beautiful red purple to being a straight up deep purple, depending on the lighting. It's a nice yarn. I don't dislike the yarn at all. I just don't think it's a good fit. So now I'm going to, oh, here. It's that yarn is Knitting Notions, hand-dyed yarn. KnittingNotionsOnline.com. I suggest it. I think it's beautiful. Classic Merino Super Sock Kettle Dyed, 420 yards. Colorway is called Red Grape. This is the label. It's in my stash if you want to go look at it. I don't know if this is a Michigan company or just somebody who, the Michigan Fiber Festival is quite large. So I think a lot of people come from miles around to kind of clear out their stock. So, but there's the label. Deep, deep, deep stash. We're talking years. So here we go. When it's all put together, I feel like I'm not really getting the definition between the two colors that I would hope for. Is this, oh, I'm showing you the wrong side. There we go. It's just kind of all, I mean, honestly, it looks more defined on screen than it is in reality. I just don't think it's working. So let me talk about the pattern for a second, though. I know this pattern is a little strange, but, and you know, I'm not a, like a diehard Stephen West fan. I don't have to knit everything he makes. I know some of his fans are like that, but I think it's pretty great. Like, they seem a little crazy until you knit them and you realize, like, this guy knows. I don't want to say this in an insulting way, like, he knows what he's doing, but, like, his techniques will teach you something. Definitely. You will learn. You know, sometimes you're knitting and you're like, this doesn't really seem like it's going to be anything. And then the next thing you know, you've done the most innovative, beautiful construction method that you never would have thought of. He is like an architect for, I'm blown away. So I don't want to like too closely tell how this is made since it is a purchase pattern and it is worth it, but it's so fun and it's so unique and it's just different. I love it. So you have this little I-cord border and then you have this I-cord going on and the way that it's done is just beautiful. So a note on this I-cord, I posted this picture on Instagram, said I was doing some hotel knitting, and you'll see that I have all these little tails. And the lovely Rizza Knits, who is Rizza Knits After Dark, she has a new podcast, which I watched a few days ago, and it is definitely worth watching, told me that to stop doing this. She was like, you don't need to do that. You can carry this yarn in your I-cord up the edge so you don't have all those edges. So look at that. And it's still stretchy. I mean, I definitely give it a good tug before I knit this next one in, but it's still nice and stretchy. And now I don't have a million stupid ends everywhere. So genius suggestion. Really pleased about that. So, but you can see I've already taken it off the cable. Like, this is no more. I need to pull it out. So I'm very excited about doing a doodler. I think I just need to come up with a better color combo. And one of the color combos I was thinking about, actually, is yarn that I've already showed you. This Fawn and the Fox to do the fan area. And then what I'm trying to figure out, I would really have to investigate here. I don't really know what color would work. I thought about just using this dark purpley color. And again, bear in mind that I've just told you that the color of this yarn changes like crazy. So I thought about just doing this with it, and then with this as my band along the bottom. So this would be like the cable along the top and the rays going through the wing shape, and then using this for the wave along the bottom. And then the other thing that I've thought about is this that I have sitting in my stash. This, again, the greens always come across more green than they really are. This is in person kind of a tealy, bright green. And there are some greens right there hiding in that skein and right there in that skein. This is kind of a fun combo. Maybe that's what it would be. So again, wave, or this is your butterfly wing. These are like your sun rays going through it and the cable. This is the wave along the bottom. And then I would probably do an accent stripe of this as part of it. That's what I'm thinking about. But at this point, like when I started this doodler, I didn't have my three color shawl in progress. I didn't have my Vildas mirror in progress. I was just working on this kind of stuff. So I think doodler is kind of going backseat for a bit, but it is definitely a priority for me. I love it. It's so fun. And I think great knitting for me teaches me something. I learn something new. And doodler is the perfect case of that. I'm definitely going to learn new things in the process. So very end, I think, let me make sure. Let me check the show notes. Make sure we talked about it. Doodler, three-color shawl, Vildas mirror, Tunisian crochet, covered it all. So the last thing, I told you I want to make socks. And I'm not trying to, like, force myself to make something I don't want to make. I want to make socks. Part of the reason I want to make socks is because a girl can only have so many shawls. And I knit at such a pace that I'm going to end up with, like, I mean, I already have a pile of shawls. I'm going to end up with, like, drawers of shawls. And I'm not in a place right now because I'm losing weight where I want to knit sweaters. That's definitely going to happen later on once I'm a little more stable. So the next logical thing for me is to make socks, to make something a little more functional. And I'm not going to show a ton here. This is that same yarn, which I've now deemed, this is like my learning yarn. This is the Knit Picks Felici in that, somebody told me that Fanciful. Somebody told me what the color was in my comments under my last video. I think Fanciful is what they said, because they said they have the same colorway. This is one that I pulled out. I frogged one of the socks that I showed you last time, and I started a new one. So I am doing this on DPNs, and when I started on DPNs at this cuff, I was like, what kind of insanity is this? Who would ever choose to make their life so miserable as to knit a sock on DPNs? It makes no sense. And I know how to knit on DPNs. This is not my first time. I understood what was happening. I thought it was madness. And now I posted this on Instagram and you guys just gave so many great suggestions. I mean, really, like so many good suggestions. Some people suggested I do them on Magic Loop. I've already done that. So I'm not opposed. I don't dislike it. I think I don't like the way the needles were in my hands. So I got to find a better needle, one that isn't physically painful to use. Some people suggested two circular needles at one time. Some people said they love DPNs and I would get a groove. A lot of people said, I think Regina specifically said, just give it some time. Like the first inch is horrible and then it'll get better. And she's right. So this is in progress. This is 2x2 rib at the top. And then I just knit for a little bit. I come from like sturdy Czechoslovakian stock. I don't have like lovely tiny little ankles. I just don't. And I have like muscular calves. So a really tall sock looks beautiful on other people. It doesn't work for me. So I did a short, I mean, this more than an ankle, but less than a calf. And then I did like a standard slip stitch heel flap, turn, and then like a little gusset. And now it's cruising right along. I'm really enjoying this. I have alternated kind of based on how many stitches I have on the needle, whether I'm doing three in a triangle or four. Right now there's four. These are the 1.5 carbons. I didn't get to choose the length because I just grabbed what was on the wall at Blazing Needles, but I'm pleased with these. So this is cruising along from here. This yarn. Oh, I wanted to show you that last time. I'll show you that in a second. This is my Yarn Friendly bag on Etsy. She is now a great friend of mine. She gifted this to me and then donated one to a previous giveaway, which has already been given away. And then I purchased one, which I gave as a giveaway, and they've all been lovely. Again, this is like a, almost like an upholstery cotton. It's a little thicker, so it stands up nicely. Perfect size for me, for socks. It's working great. So as part of this sock process, one of the things that I really got to figure out is what, you know, so much of knitting socks, I think, is figuring out what works for your foot. It's not everybody needs the same stitch count. For me, I actually need more stitches at the start than I do later on. So I've had to kind of create some wonky, there's actually, when I was decreasing here, I decreased further and then kind of resituated my stitches because I had more on the back than on the front. It'll work out, I promise you. But I'm still trying to figure out what, like, do I need 64 stitches? Do I need 68 stitches? Do I need 72 stitches? What gauge do I knit at with the carbon? So versus those Nova cubics, because it's definitely different. How many rows of ribbing, all those kind of things. So I am pleased though. Like, I have knit very, very few socks and this makes me really happy. It's like really clean, no holes. I've managed to learn how to pick up this edge nicely. So I'm not displeased with this one. I just gotta, you know, with a sock, you can kind of try it on as you go along, but it's not till that baby is done and blocked that you know if it's really a good fit. And I've ended up with socks that are way too small, like this little guy, way too small. And then I've ended up with socks that are, this one is not, it's not too small. It's like too short. It fits like a, like one of those little footies that you use to try on shoes. It's ridiculous. I've ended up with socks that are too big. So it's just a learning process. And I've resigned myself that that's what this skein of yarn is going to become. It's going to be my learning sock yarn. And hopefully I'll get it figured out. DPN so far, hate the first inch. But from there, pretty good. Not too bad. So I'm going to try those Nova Platina DPNs next. And then we'll try the little baby circulars. And maybe I'll even try a different magic loop, just not the Nova Cubics that hurt my hands. This is what I pulled out of the bag, just the tag for Mrs. Brown's bags. I knew I was holding on to this to show you. I just didn't know where I put it. So there you go. There's all the info. Okay, guys, I'm sure this is so long at this point. This isn't going to be like a teaser. I'll just tell you, I love so many podcasts at this point. There are like new ones coming out every day. I love the community and how much everybody supports each other. I have pages and pages of subscriptions that I'm not just subscribed, that I actually watch. At this point, I don't watch TV. I don't watch Hulu. I don't watch Netflix. I just watch podcasts and I love them. So I talk about podcasts in passing as part of the conversation. On that note, Stripey Socks Knit Along with Candace of Pin Feathers and Pearls. That's what these socks are going for. That was not intentional, but I was like, hey, stripes, socks, knit along, sure, let's do it. So when a podcast comes up, I kind of talk about it, but I definitely don't make an effort to explicitly tell you what podcast I'm watching. And it's one, because these videos are already insanely long. And two, because as a podcaster, I love hearing about other podcasts. I love when I get mentioned. I love when we talk about each other. I love the community. As a viewer, I worry that you guys are like, really, again, are we all talking about the same podcast? Are we all just talking in circles? So what I've decided to do, and it's going to happen very soon, hopefully within a few days, hopefully up no later than next week, is I want to do for you my personal ABCs of podcasts. I have started, I'm not going to say much more from that. I have started pulling together my list. These are all podcasts that I legitimately watch and love and admire. I learn things from them. They enable me to buy stash that I don't need. So my personal ABCs of podcasts, where I can give love to all the podcasts that I adore so much. And then you guys can reference back to it if you ever want to. It's coming soon. So with that, I think I just got to call it a day. As always, I could keep going for forever, but we got to stop somewhere. So very, very happy to be back. I feel energized. I feel excited. I love what I'm working on. I got, as you see, a ton of stash to work through. If you guys have any questions about 12 and 12, if you have any questions about the three-color cowl knit along, don't forget to submit your finished object photos so you can be in a drawing to win that Fawn Knits. Oh, Fawn Knits is her Instagram. Fawn and the Fox bag. And that skein of Toil and Trouble yarn and my felted yarn bowl. So many things. If you guys have any questions, you know where to find me. I'm on Instagram. I'm on Ravelry. I'm obviously on YouTube. It was great to see you again. I'm really excited to be back, and I will see you guys next time. Bye.